What does the life in a mathematics student, what's a day in the life? Sorry, I haven't got this the question wrong.
What opportunities do your, oh, nope, messed that one up.
Oh, I'm next, yes. Sorry. Do you want me to start?
Sorry.
Hi, my name is Sarah, and I'm a lecturer at the School of Mathematics and Physics at UQ, and I'm here with Sean to answer your questions. Okay, I've got the first question. What has been the most unexpected thing you have been happy to discover at UQ?
For me, one of the things that I was like not expecting was actually the dynamic between lecturers and students. Yeah. Because you go from school where you're like sitting in a classroom and you call them Mr. and Mrs. or Sir or whatever it may be, and then they'll jump in and they've got like 20 years experience, they literally got a PhD, they've done groundbreaking research, and they're like, hi guys, I'm Dave. And then they're like, so the lecturers are so happy to just talk to you about anything. They're really welcoming and open with their time. I wasn't expecting them to be so happy for you to just rock up, like organize a time for you to be one-on-one to explain some of the coursework.
Yeah.
That's one of the things I wasn't expecting, but I think it's great, and it actually helped me learn a lot.
Well, for me as a lecturer, that's like one of the most rewarding parts of the job,
yeah,
too. I love that student interaction, and yeah, if you have a set office hour time and like nobody shows up, you're sort of thinking, where is everybody? But I love it when students do want to come and chat, or when you can chat in lecture itself. That's,
yeah,
also really fun.
So what is it about the UQ's approach that makes us the most employable graduates in the state?
I think for one thing, we give students good, challenging problems to work on during their degree. And I think that by seeing a problem that at the outset looks really challenging, and then you make some progress on that and you realize, oh, hold on, I can tackle that, then you gain that confidence to take a look at any other problem, whether it be in industry or somewhere else, and actually make progress there and not be afraid from the outset. The other thing I think we do really well is focus on communication. I think it's really incredible to see our students getting opportunities to practice their science communication or their mathematics communication, and I think that's an incredibly valuable skill. What does a day in the life of a mathematics student look like?
It really depends day to day, because you've got lectures, you've also got tutorials and sometimes practicals, or times where you're working in computer labs.
Yeah.
But normally I wake up, come to uni, spend anywhere between 3 and 5 hours doing some uni work, then go home and I get a chance to do whatever else I need to do.
And how much work would you say you spend on self-study outside of the directed lecture and workshop sort of tutorial?
Not enough.
What would you recommend?
Okay, so they say you should spend, I think it's 10 hours per subject per week.
Yeah.
Which comes to about 40 hours, which is manageable.
Yeah.
And normally that also includes like lecture and prac and tutorial times. And they tell you that. So it's somewhere between 2 and 3 hours per subject per week.
Yep.
Sometimes it's more because you've just got to focus on this assignment, or you've got this exam coming up, so you'll have to do a little bit more, but sometimes it's a little less. What opportunities do your students have to get hands-on experience in our industry?
So in mathematics at the department, we have industry placement, and we also have summer research programs and winter research programs and the ANSI summer school and winter school. So I think those give really good examples where students can get into industry or even work with an academic on a research problem over a semester and just see how that works for them.
Nice.
What are the most valuable skills you've learned as part of your degree?
So one of them is communication, and you mentioned before. It's something that perhaps we're lacking in the sciences. Like, well, while we're able to have a discussion,
yeah,
about maths things, it can be difficult to just bring that out to your grandma who did high school maths and she was great at that,
yes,
but she's missing 3 years that we've just built upon our knowledge.
So understanding your audience.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. You've got to sort of tailor it to who's listening.
Yeah.
And I think that's a focus that was in first year,
yeah,
we actually looked at. All right, how do you prepare students for the future when we don't know what the future looks like?
That's a really good question. And I think that being able to take a hard problem or a complicated, slightly ambiguous problem,
yeah,
and then not feel scared of it, I think that skill just is so broadly applicable that no matter what future directions you go in, that skill will serve you.
Yeah.
And I think that mathematics training really gives you that sort of foundational ability to take a hard problem
and
then sort of make it into a formal problem and make progress on that. And I think that that way of thinking makes you unafraid to tackle new things. So I think even unafraid in other areas.
So
I think that's probably the biggest skill, is trying things that challenge you. Yeah. How does the way you learn at UQ teach you the skills that you need to face an unknown future?
Certainly with the vast majority of lecturers I've had, they've taught the content that they have to get through, but they know what is needed in the actual job, which is sometimes different from the specific coursework. And so I've had some of the best recommendations on what is the really valuable skills that you're going to go through in life. In my third year statistics courses, the lecturers are just, they'll talk about the theory behind it and perhaps the special, like the precise mathematics. But then almost every lecture, they'll say, right, so we're going to go into maybe MATLAB or maybe R, some computer programming software, and we're going to do an example. And it doesn't really matter the numbers, but they show this is what you're doing. And so when you get a different problem, you just go straight into the software, start doing it, and it does incredibly complex things incredibly quickly.
It does, yes, but I mean, having that foundational understanding means that when you run the program, you understand what's going on, rather than just running it and saying, I believe this output, even though the output might be wrong based on what you've done.
Definitely.
So I think that understanding the fundamental mathematics that underpins those programs is an incredibly useful set knowledge base, but also the skill of being able to ask the program to do something for you, that's really an incredible skill.
Definitely. If you were employing the next mathematics graduate, what would you be looking for?
So somebody with strong quantitative foundations, but more than the strong foundations, it's sort of like a curiosity.
Okay.
Someone who's actually passionate about a question and can also communicate their curiosity. If somebody is very passionate about what they're looking at and can communicate that to others, I think that's an incredibly valuable skill. And the quantitative side is really important, having that basic foundation, but it's probably not as important to be like 100% marks everywhere as it is to balance with the passion and the curiosity, I'd say, as well. What do you think employers in your industry are looking for? And how do you think UQ has equipped you with these skills?
I think there's two big ones. And the ones I was thinking about is you've got to be able to work in a multidisciplinary team.
Yes.
And the other one, which sort of feeds into it, is you've got to be able to get to the essence of a problem. Often you'll probably be working and you'll be either you personally, just yourself, or you and a team will be the maths specialists that help other people do their jobs in some other field. They'll often come to you with their problems, and this is where the second part comes in of getting to the essence of the problem. They'll talk to you in their language about this is what's going on, we need the solution to this, and you need to be able to pick out the maths parts.
Yes.
And then often it's helpful to present it back to them in the way they're used to.
Yes.
Because they might just tune out if you start going for the maths side of it.
Yeah.
But you don't need to, because you're confident and you've done that. You can just say, this is what we can do. This is where we go from there.
And do you feel like you've developed that skill to pull out the essence of a problem and then also to communicate it to different sorts of teams?
Definitely. There's been on more than one occasion, like more than one course, we've had a maths style problem. It might be like talking about the statistics around an experiment, and they'll be very clearly assessing your skills, and they teach that and help you with that in tutorials and lectures. If you could give me one piece of advice that would set me apart as a job candidate, what would it be?
I would say breadth of experience as well as depth, right? So I would say, as well as studying the mathematics and all the foundation that you are working on, thinking about, as you say, you like zoology.
Yeah.
The fact that you've gained that breadth and you've looked at the way somebody else might work in, say, an interdisciplinary field or a multidisciplinary field, that breadth will make you a stronger candidate, I believe.
Yeah. Okay, so is it, you said breadth and depth. Is there a balance that you sort of need to be favoring one or the other?
I would say depth is probably very important if you want to be a specialist.
Right.
But you want a sprinkling of that breadth, otherwise you become too sort of centered on only what you do, and you don't
right.
see how other people view that.
Okay.
And I think that that breadth is really important to gain somewhere, even if it's in a first year interdisciplinary course, or if it's in a dual degree, or if it's in an industry placement, or even it doesn't have to be in your coursework,
yep.
but it can be through like UQ life things, UQ
okay.
teams or volunteering or something
yep.
like that, that gives you breadth beyond just the rigor of your study, I think.
What makes a good student, and are they the same things that make a good job candidate?
They probably are quite similar things, yeah. So I would say a good attitude towards the problems that
okay.
you're working on, and the ability to schedule your time as well. And that's something that I think students really maybe lack at the beginning, but really do develop quite quickly. So a good student is somebody who can manage their time, is unafraid to take on problems, and then is unafraid to sort of talk to other people when they get stuck. Because in the real world, in industry or in any job, if you are stuck on something, you should talk to your boss or talk to your colleagues about whatever it is that you're stuck on. And I think that lack of fear to communicate with other people and to sort of push forward on a problem, I think that's a really useful skill. That's hard to write down on a resume though, isn't it?
Yeah.
So I think that you get some of that from the breadth of what you study.
Right. Okay.
And also just through a degree, you learn some of these skills anyways, the time management and that sort of ability to communicate to others. What have you learned about yourself since you began your studies at UQ?
When I came in first year, I knew I was good at science. I knew I was good at maths. I'd done well enough at school to be able to get into the program at UQ.
Yep.
But I didn't really know what kind of study, like what kind of science I wanted to look at.
Yep.
In high school, I'd focused mainly on chemistry and physics,
mm-hmm.
but I took a biology course and realized that that's actually really interesting.
Yeah.
And it wasn't actually till I did a second year course that I was like, wow, I really, really love animals. Like I just enjoy spending time with animals.
Yeah.
Until I'd done that, those courses,
yep.
although I knew I liked animals, it hadn't really clicked with me that you can do this, you can study this, and this can be part of your
yeah.
life.
And that deeper understanding of them gave you more of an appreciation for them?
Definitely.
Yeah, cool.
Yeah, yeah.
That's
there's
awesome.
Some very cool animals out there.
That's awesome.
Sweet. I think we're done.
I think that was my last question too.
Is that it?